Without further ado, Alexander Waugh.
Thank you very much.
Hooray. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. It's very nice to be here. You're going to have to concentrate a tiny bit, so there is a danger I'll actually blunt your minds rather than sharpen them, but I'm going to do my best. I'm just going to say something before we get onto what I'm really talking about, which is the Stratford grave. I hope you can hear me. I just mentioned the Henry James that was read earlier, and I'm not sure if everybody knows this, so I think it is worth saying, that Henry James story is in fact based upon real events. And in case you don't know this, if you go to Stratford today to something called the Shakespeare birthplace, what you're actually entering is a house that was built in 1858, between 1858 and 1864. there's a photograph of it in 1857, which is a hole in the ground. And I think it's highly unlikely, even if that 19th century house was built upon a site that John Shakespeare had, he did have a site on Henry Street, we're not absolutely sure it's that site, even if it were that site, that site was bought 12 years after Shakespeare of Stratford was born anyway. So he certainly wasn't born in a house built after 1858 and probably wasn't, and definitely wasn't born on the site. But who knows, his father may have had something there. The only other thing is that in 1891, this fellow called Joseph Skipsey, Joseph Skipsey, who was in charge of the Shakespeare birthplace, resigned, saying he couldn't bear to do this any longer and couldn't bear telling lies and couldn't bear the bogosity of the whole thing and the fraudulence. And that's what Henry James based. I think the Henry James story is about 1903, am I right? And this happened in 1891. It was in all the newspapers. Right, let's get to the subject in hand. And actually, it relates because it's Stratford. I'm going to talk today about the grave of Shakespeare or Shakespeare. I don't mean any offence to anybody when I say Shakespeare. It's just for clarity. If I say Shakespeare or Stratford Shakespeare, then you probably all know I'm talking about the fellow who was unquestionably born in 1564 in Stratford-upon-Avon. Just for clarity, if I say Shakespeare, then I'm talking about the author, whoever that may be. The first thing we know about the grave in Stratford-upon-Avon is that a fellow in 1618, the vicar was called Rogers then, and Rogers was called to task for taking money and putting it in his back pocket for selling the rights to be buried in the chancel. Now, we know this. For quite a long time, it's been said that Shakespeare, because he's such a great writer, is buried in the chancel. Evidence doesn't show that, and I'll come to that in a second. Or B, because he had bought the things called the welcome, the tithes, and the welcome enclosures, and that gave him a right. Well, that's not right now either. Robert Bierman has shown beyond any question of doubt now that to get buried in the chancel, you have to pay. And there was a big fuss about it in 1618. Interestingly enough, there are no graves in that part of the chancel that date from that sort of 1618 period, apart from the Shakespeare graves, which are all in a line. So it's very possible he was getting himself into trouble for taking money for the Shakespeare graves. Now, this raises a very, very interesting question, because we've had it read out to us already today. Here is the text on the stone under which Shakespeare is supposed to be lying. Good friend, for Jesus' sake, forbear to dig the dust, enclose it here. Blessed be the man who spares these stones, and cursed be he who moves my bones. So the one thing that's absolutely obvious about that, the first thing we notice, is it doesn't have the name Shakespeare on it. It doesn't laud the fellow for doing this absolutely extraordinary work and being such a great artist, writer, or anything of the sort. And the main motivation, it would seem, the main message we're getting from that is, please don't move this stone. Now, whoever paid for the position in the chancel only then to put this cheap, shoddy piece of stone without someone's name on it, which basically says only one thing, do not move this stone, was behaving very oddly indeed. And we've got to accept that that's very odd. I think we've also got to accept that, given it doesn't have Shakespeare's name on it, that there is legitimate doubt about who or what might be buried underneath this stone. Now, I would like to move, if I may, to this screen here. So what do we know about Shakespeare's burial? Ben Jonson in 1623 in the first folio, my Shakespeare, rise, I will not lodge thee by Chaucer or Spenser or bid Beaumont lie a little further. Now, in case you don't know this, There's a lineup in Westminster Abbey in what we now call Poets' Corner, where Beaumont lies next to Chaucer, who lies next to Spenser. So Johnson's saying, I'm not going to ask you, Shakespeare, to move there, because thou art a monument without a tomb. OK, a bit confusing, don't know what that means, but it means one thing, he doesn't have a tomb, OK? So already we're beginning to cast a little bit of doubt on the picture I just showed you. 7 years later, we have John Milton in what looks slightly sulky mood. What need my Shakespeare for his honoured bones, a labour of an age in piled stones, or that his hallowed relics should be hid under a star-appointed pyramid? Dear son of memory, great heir of fame, what needs thou such dull witness of thy name? So he seems to be saying, oh, you haven't got a tomb, it doesn't matter anyway, never mind, your works are very good. But again, we've got two witnesses who are heavily implying that Shakespeare does not have a tomb. Now, what happens next? This will be familiar to many of you. This is the epitaph upon Shakespeare, as it is, hyphen Spear, as it is in, I think, the second time it was ever printed like that, supposedly by William Bass, certainly written after March 1616, because that's when Beaumont died, and probably written before 1623, because that's Johnson appears to be responding to it. So he says, renowned Spenser, again we're going back to this sort of Westminster Abbey issue, renowned Spenser, lie a thought more nigh to learned Chaucer, and rare Beaumont, lie a little nearer Spenser, to make room for Shake hyphen Spear in your threefold, fourfold tomb. So it's a very direct plea to say, please can we make room for Shakespeare in Westminster Abbey next to those three. To lodge all four in one bed, make a shift. We're not terribly interested in reading that bit of it. There's no particular need now. Now, what he's basically saying is if we can't move you, Shakespeare, if you can't be moved to be alongside Chaucer and Spenser and Beaumont, oh, well, never mind. Then underneath this marble of thine own, sleep, rare tragedian Shakespeare, sleep alone. Now, we're already in a bit of a problem here because I just showed you the picture and we don't have to be experts on stones to see that that stone I showed you was not marble. It was simply stone. And in eight of the old manuscripts of this poem, it says underneath this uncarved marble. So in other words, it's got no writing carved on it and it's marble. I showed you the picture. It was stone and it was carved. So this guy seems to be saying, Shakespeare, you seem to be under this uncarved marble and we would like to move you into Westminster Abbey to be near Spenser and Beaumont and Chaucer. What I've put on the right here is something that many of you might not have seen. I took this photo. So all the photographs I took were totally out of focus. I don't know how to use my camera at all. What it is it's from the manuscript of William Dugdale's Antiquities of Warwickshire. And as we all know, he has a little bit on Stratford-upon-Avon. At the top, I could have given you the whole of that. It's quite extraordinary. It's the absolute mess and rubbings out to try and write this one little possibly lying paragraph about William Shakespeare. And he's having a great problem writing it. But underneath, you'll see that he intended originally to put the Bass poem into the book, but he crosses it out. He's scored it out, and of course, it doesn't appear in the book. Now, we can all guess why he scored it out. Maybe it was lack of space, but maybe it was he realised he was writing about Stratford-upon-Avon, and you cannot be writing about Stratford-upon-Avon and William Shakespeare's grave that says, under this marble you're lying when you're not. It looked wrong, so he got rid of it quite correctly. Now, it's my view that the stone under which he lies has been fiddled about with. And we're all supposed to pretend that that stone has never been lifted, and we're all absolutely terrified of the curse that is laid upon the person who lifts it. A curse, in my mind, has been placed there very, very deliberately to stop people lifting the stone, because we know very well what will happen if we lift it. We'll see that there's nothing underneath it, and nobody was ever buried under it. But I'd like just to show you some of the evidence which shows it already has been lifted, and people at some point jolly well knew what was underneath it. So, let's just have a look. Stevens, this is George Stevens, the great Shakespearean scholar, in 1788. So that's a long time ago. And he notes, writing about Shakespeare, he goes up to Stratford-upon-Avon, he looks at the grave, and he takes down an inscription of what it looks like. And he notes, and we quote, in Stephen's day, that the inscription is, I quote, expressed in the following uncouth mixture of small and capital letters. Now you can see there how sake is enormous. You know, I've got a little spotty thing there. Look at that weird A jumping out of there. All that is not on there, is it? So that in itself, and we've got another, by the way, we have one other testimony to this in a handwritten manuscript, that's how it originally looked. So someone has recarved it. Now, you obviously can't recarve it without lifting the stone. It's one of the things you need to understand about it. I would also like to quote, if I may, I would like to quote Halliwell Phillips, who was, as many of you will know, was perhaps the greatest Shakespearean scholar of the 19th century. In 1881, Halliwell Phillips wrote that he believed that the stone had been changed in the 1830s, and lamenting that, and I quote, "The original memorial has wandered from its allotted station to no man can tell whither, a sacrifice to the insane worship of prosaic neatness, that mischievous demon whose votaries have practically destroyed so many of the priceless relics of ancient England and her gifted sons." So in 1881, Halliwell Phillips is telling you that this was changed probably in the 1830s. Now, I've come across a little bit more proof, which is exciting. Once again, extremely badly photographed by me, and I strongly apologize. This is a ground map of what's going on in the church, and it was done in 1836. Please bear that date in mind. Here's the altar railing at the bottom, so the altar's here, and here are the so-called Shakespeare graves going across here. This one is Shakespeare's grave. And you'll notice that it's a very silly shape. Can you see that? It's sloping. It's not an accident. This wasn't a badly drawn piece of architectural drawing, and you can tell it wasn't, because if you look at this one, which is Hall's grave next to it, at the top he says it's 3'7" across there, and at the bottom it's 3'4". So he's been extremely precise, and he's showing you that this stone is wider at the top than at the bottom, and therefore it slants in that sort of sense there. This means that the Shakespeare stone is a weird shape. It's not an exact rectangle like it is today. I'd also point out here that he's got written Roman tiles. Well, those aren't there today. I'd also point out, if you go today, you'll see these. It's got one there, the coat of arms, the Hall coat of arms. They're on all of these ones. Well, they're jolly well not there in 1836, so someone's been asking about. This grave is interesting. If you go to Stratford today, this is the grave of Susanna, the daughter of Stratford Shakespeare. What does it actually say there? You probably can't read it, but I can. I'm sorry about that, it's really bad. It says Richard Watts of Ryan Clifford. So who's gone and put Stratford's daughter suddenly in that one, changed that, put some more things on there, changed that stone there? There's been an awful lot of arsing around. Now let's go to what we're actually, now we all pay to go up to Stratford, one of the earliest churches in England to charge money to go to into it. So here we go. Take my money. What do we see? Bing, yippee-i-do. We see that. This, I think, is made of plastic. And is the only thing in the whole church that tells you that the poet William Shakespeare is buried there. Now, what you'll notice is a little bit of storytelling is going on in that presentation. We can forget that bit there. This is the stone here, okay? It's the stone we've been talking about that's been replaced. You can see it's a perfectly good shape there. It's not slanting or anything. And they've put a rope all the way down there and all the way along there and all the way up there. That's to tell a little story. That's to say, oops, we have a problem. This stone is 3'7" long by 3 foot across. That's a bit too small for a grown man, and one does assume that the great man who wrote Othello did live into adulthood to be big enough to be a man. So what they're saying, and traditionally what happens when you're buried in a church, if you're buried near the altar, is your feet are altar first and your head is away from the altar. So what they're trying to say by placing this rope here is that Shakespeare's head is somewhere here and his body is somewhere going down there. That would be odd, because this stone, which you can't tell, there's no line actually underneath this rope. This stone is a big stone that goes right across here like that. It's one big stone. Now, this causes no end of problem. So, I don't know if any of you saw a recent television program in which a fellow called Kevin Kulse, Kevin Kulse, an archaeologist working with the Shakespeare Birthplace Trust, argued that the small space under the stone... The problem they've got here is, as I said, getting the body right across there. So he argued that the small space under that little stone there would have been large enough to accommodate an adult corpse if it had not been reduced in size by workmen fixing a problem of subsidence caused by grave robbers removing Shakespeare's skull. It was all over the front pages of lots of newspapers. Shakespeare's skull's been stolen. Well, I'm about to show you that what the headline should have said is Shakespeare's grave's empty. It never was a grave. But I think they panicked because they realised there was a big problem. So they invented this story to steal the headlines, and it worked very well. What happened was something called a GPR scan, that's a ground-penetrating radar scan, was passed over this with the permission of the vicar. Now, I've already told you the horror of the fact that this is 3.7 foot, that's 3 foot. It gets worse. The depth of this grave is 3 foot. Worse still, that the GPR scan showed that underneath here is a solid partition. So there's no room for a body to be going through there. So panic, panic, panic for the Birthplace Trust. How the hell are we going to explain this? By the way, I should also point out that the GPR scan found no nails, which you would find if there'd been a coffin, no sense of any coffin, no shroud, no bones. It's only 3 foot deep. Whoopsie, whoopsie, it is really not looking like a grave, and now we're beginning to understand why someone doesn't want you lifting it and looking underneath it. Actually, I've already told you that I believe the stone has been moved because it's been recarved and reshaped. I perhaps forgot to mention Washington Irving in 1820 when he visited Stratford, and he published a thing saying a few years back he met the sexton, and the sexton of Stratford Church had said that some years ago he opened the grave, and I quote, "I could see neither coffin nor bones, nothing but dust." So come on, and guess what? All of this stuff I'm telling you right now, the stuff about being a man without a tomb, no coffin but dust, none of this appeared on this program, none of it. So what the idea is then, is that this Kulse man trying to save the Stratford story, it was an archaeologist on behalf of the Shakespeare Birthplace Trust, so he says, I'll tell you what happened. Grave robbers loved stealing skulls, particularly of people like Shakespeare, so they must have come along one day, lifted it up, stolen the skull. By removing the skull, that would have caused some subsidence, and the subsidence would have meant that workmen would have had to come in, build up a support here, and put a new structure in here. How mad is it? I can tell you quite how mad it is. Let's have a look here. The average man, the average height of a man in 1616 was, believe it or not, 5'7". We used to think for many years he was much smaller than that due to the size of doors. But it seemed to be fashionable to stoop when you went through doors, and it doesn't have much to do with it. They've now done bone measurements, and they know that the average size is 5'7". So I've put a Harvard-diagnosed medical proportional man. I've laid him down on there. Look where his head is. There's his little head up there. So we're told that his head was taken out of the grave, and by missing that, the whole of the structure subsided, and they had to put a new support underneath there. I'm sorry, I'm going to say no more about it than it's just silly. Let's move on. Let's move on instead to this hideous object about which we we all know quite a lot. We have slight disagreements amongst us all about the exact date and things. I can give you my own views. I'm absolutely certain, and the evidence is very, very strong, that these capitals and the pillars were all changed in 1778, as Keir Cutler pointed out. Actually, I believe that this fellow, the whole bust, was replaced in 1649, 1650. We know that money was spent in the chancel at that time. If you look carefully at this little moustache, That was absolute banging fashion in 1649, 1650, and it was totally unheard of in the time when Shakespeare was writing. So I think the whole bust was replaced, and as many of you will know, what was added was this prayer cushion and this piece of paper and the quill, which is actually a real quill. It sometimes gets stolen, sometimes gets lost, it's sometimes replaced, but having the hand like that. The cherubs and everything on top, which I might have time to talk about, have gone. By the way, what I'm aiming at, I'll give you an advanced sense of what I'm aiming at here. I believe that monuments like this were not made, you know, everyone has been looking at this monument and saying, oh, look at that, and let's argue about that. Oh, look at this bit down here, let's argue about that. Look at the cherubs at the top, let's argue about those. When these things were made, they were made in a unified form, and that it was a holistic design, and everything relates to everything else. That is the centre of my argument. And I have quite a bit of evidence to show that this whole thing was designed, actually, please don't look at that, because it's so disgusting, by Ben Jonson. Ben Jonson, you may not know this, but Ben Jonson had a hand in designing the Fenchurch arch when King James came into London. He had all those famous squabbles with Inigo Jones over how you do stage sets. He had a great eye for the plastic arts and for architecture. And I believe, and I'll show you a bit more evidence as I go along when we come to talking about what's written on it, that Jonson actually designed the whole thing, and it was done roughly about the same time as the first folio was going on. Let's have a look at this. Can I draw your attention to these two images? Many of you will know them. These are two 17th century images of the monument as it was then. Now, the bust on the monument, sorry. The very first thing you'll notice is that both of them, this, by the way, is by the very famous and very accurate and brilliant engraver called Wenceslas Hollar, and it appears first in Dugdale's Antiquities of Warwickshire. And this is Dugdale's drawing, believed to date possibly as early as 1634. So this would be the very, very earliest drawing we have of the Shakespeare monument. Now, the first thing that strikes the eye is that he's carrying not just any old sack, he's carrying a very specific type of sack known as a wool pack with the four knots at each corner. So what we're being told here, very, very obviously and very straightforwardly, is this guy's a wool dealer. Now, we do have some evidence, manuscript evidence, saying a bit late, it has to be said, but that Shakespeare was a wool comber. We know for a fact that his father dealt in wool and got into lots of squabbles about wool and weighing of wool. If you and that Shakespeare of Stratford increased the land holdings at Stratford after his father died, so there's a very strong chance that he was dealing in wool. If you were a wool dealer in the provinces in those days, and you're bringing your wool into London, you had to have it weighed, guess where, at the grocer's hall. Guess who was an apprentice at the grocer's hall during all that time? A fellow called John Hemmings, and his job was weighing wool. He then became in charge of weighing coal coming into London. He loved weighing things. Hemmings, we're always told Hemmings was an actor. Well, maybe he did act a few parts. He had a stutter, as we all know, so I don't expect he was the best of actors. But essentially, he was a man of business, rather like Stratford Shakespeare, I believe, to have been. And they probably made friends when they were weighing wool down in London. And they said, how about, you know, I love theatre. Oh, so right. Should we invest a bit of money in theatre? Yes, why not? I tell you what, if you give them a bit of extra money, they'll let you have a part. You can walk on stage and have a part. it shows he's a wool dealer. What kind of wool dealer can we tell from this? Well, you can look at the jacket as long as you like. But what really interests me is the slope of the shoulder. Let's have a look at this. This extraordinarily long arm and what almost looks like a claw here. And here as well, look at the joint. And look at those big muscular arms coming forward. I'm not standing here to tell you today that I think this is very interesting evidence that William Shakespeare of Stratford was very strong. I'm telling you it's very interesting evidence that this wool dealer was an ape. Well, you may laugh, but actually, look at it carefully. These are the dimensions of an ape. These are ape-like arms, very long. That is the shoulders of a gorilla. If you know how the structure, the anatomy of a gorilla works, they come out there because they descend from quadrupeds. You know, they're not like us with our shoulders back there. So the question then arises, and I think it's a very legitimate question, what the hell's going on here? Why should the Shakespeare monument have a wool dealer who's an ape on it. Now, I did say that I thought that Ben Jonson was possibly behind the whole design of the Stratford Monument. In 1616, Ben Jonson published this poem called On Poet Ape. Just to remind you that a poet ape means, according to the lingo of the day, an actor. Ape is to imitate. A poet ape is someone who apes or imitates what the poet produces. Poor poet ape that would be thought our chief, whose works are e'en the frippery of wit. From now, works, by the way, don't panic. Works is the things that he does. Don't start thinking he's written a lot of works. That's a trick. Whose works are e'en the frippery of wit. From brokerage, so he's a dealer, this poet ape, is become so bold a thief as we the robbed leave rage and pity it. At first he makes low shifts, would pick and glean, by the reversion of old plays, now grown to a little wealth and credit in the scene. He takes up all, makes each man's wit his own, and told of this, he slights it. Tut, such crimes the sluggish, gaping auditor devours. Now, I do not wish to be rude in any way to Stratfordians, and any Stratfordians in this room know I love them, but I just point out this. That is Jonson, that's the first ever description of a Stratfordian. The sluggish, gaping auditor is swallowing up this story. What are we being told? This actor is a broker. He's buying up the reversion of old plays. And he's allowing people, he's not necessarily saying it, he's not saying, I wrote these plays, but he's allowing the sluggish, gaping auditor to assume that he might be writing them. He marks not whose 'twas at first, and after times may judge it be his as well as ours. Fool, as if half eyes will not know a fleece from locks of wool or shreds from the whole piece. Now, a fleece, as we all know, is a pun on to fleece, to rip off, to steal someone's clothes, in fact, it means. But the little joke, you always put the sting of your epigram in the last two lines, the little joke is, of course, he's a wool dealer. So we've got a wool dealer who's buying the reversions for old plays. He's made a little credit on the scene. He's got quite rich. And ho-ho, he would be thought our chief. I wonder if he has a name very, very similar to a certain pseudonym. Let's have a look here. This is a slightly bigger picture. It's the same one I was showing you before. There's the very apish structure. This is Dugdale. See, he's come into a little wealth, this man is a wool dealer. And there's a little, tiny little further corroboration here of the fact that this was intended to be an ape and to be poet ape. Can I please draw your attention to these capitals? Can you remember that the word capital comes from the Latin capita, meaning a head? One thing you'll notice is this is what, at first glance, is a very standard Corinthian capital. There's acanthus leaves here and there, but look how every little stroke, he's done it precisely the same on both sides. A little hole there, a little hole. He's taken the leaf's gone round, the leaf up there. So he's duplicated. It's not just a sort of slapdash, oh, let's quickly do a picture of a Corinthian capital. Now, can you just watch with a tiny bit of care this capital here? Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to put it on his head. I think I've got a way of doing that. There he goes. Wee. Well. What have we got there? And you notice I didn't rescale it, I just plopped it on. And it fits. How extraordinary. Now some of you will be saying, don't be silly, Alexander. This is a Christian church and quite a famous one at that. People don't do these silly things. And are you saying that the capital originally looked like an ape's face? That's just to show you, this is actually an 18th century engraving of a capital that was dug up in ancient Rome. And you can see, actually, the further away, the easier, because actually I'm so close I can hardly see it, but at the back you'll see very clearly that this is made to look like a rather spooky face, a bit more like a bull, and there's actually a little face within it, and there's a sort of big face there. This one I just put for a bit of fun. This is a reconstruction of what I believe was originally on the Shakespeare monument. So you can see how Dugdale drew it. He saw that with a little hole for the mouth and the ears. and it's a little monkey's face, but just to show that it can happen three-dimensionally, and to show here that there is a great tradition of creating faces out of capital. And as we all know, by the way, in case you're having any other doubts about this, we know that people wrote epitaphs in Christian churches that mocked and laughed the people who were supposedly being commemorated. In fact, in the Stratford Church, there's a very famous, it's gone now, an epigram about someone called Coombe, so Mr. Coombe the Bachelor, and it talks in very naughty ways about how he spread his seed all over the place and a lot of double, and he's obviously had a lot of babies in the village, in the town. And there's a man called Richard Brathwaite, some of you will have come across it, he wrote a whole book of epitaphs, contemporary epitaphs, which made jokes. So I think it's in a good tradition that was going on in the day. William Dugdale, who the man who wrote this book, this is really quite irrelevant, but I just thought quite interesting, actually. It's often been argued that Dugdale was a useless drawer and he didn't know what he was doing. He just did a bad drawing and he wasn't concentrating. This is rubbish. William Dugdale was highly acclaimed, very, very important drawer for the heralds, the coats of arms. I have actually been to Merivale where all his manuscripts are. I've looked through every single drawing. Every single drawing he does is totally in proportion and totally brilliant, apart from this one here. Dugdale, in a book, had written as though he didn't know the difference between an ape and a man. It just happened I found this quite funny. He's talking about someone answering back about something. He says his reply was no more like an answer than an ape is like a man. It's almost a joke that he jolly well knows the difference between an ape and a man, and that what he's actually drawn here is what he saw, and that is an anatomical ape. Now look at here. This, I think, is very interesting. Dugdale published his book in 1656. His greatest friend and neighbour was called Sir Aston Cockayne, both lived in Warwickshire, very next to Dugdale. And Dugdale Aston Cockayne praising Dugdale's book, writes, "The skilfullest anatomist that yet upon an humane body e'er did sit did never so precisely show his art as you have yours. In you, in your way, do them in theirs exceed. You make the dead to live, they spoil the dead." I mean, he's saying to Dugdale, apropos of his book in which he draws Shakespeare looking like an ape, he's saying, "You're better than any human anatomist, you're so accurate." And what's the very next thing he says when he's been talking about the brilliance of the human anatomy drawings in Dugdale's book? "Now Stratford-upon-Avon we would choose, thy gentle and ingenuous Shakespeare muse." So he goes straight from talking the brilliance of his anatomy drawings straight to this thing about Shakespeare muse. Now, you only have to go to the Oxford English Dictionary and look up muse and how it was used in those days. One thing is deception. Ingenuous, honourably straightforward. So Dugdale's best friend, closest ally, Warwickshire person who lived in Warwickshire, says, "You're the best at drawing anatomy that ever could be. Now to Stratford, we would choose your gentle," which could mean noble, "ingenuous, honourably straightforward Shakespeare deception." Now, let's come to this, because this is extremely interesting, and I'm sure you've all had lots of time to gawp at it and lots of time to try and work out what it means. So Stanley Wells. Okay, this is so important, but this is... I think you'll forgive me if I just do end up going 5 minutes over, because this is the crunch of what I've come here to say, and I think you'll be astounded. You can actually forget all the ape stuff. Listen. Seriously listen to this. This is very interesting. Right, we've had centuries of people not understanding this about. What does it mean? What's the fellow saying? "Stay, passenger, why goest thou by so fast? Readest thou canst whom envious death hath placed within this monument, Shakespeare." Take a breath. Heavens, that is not what we call a syntactically clever sentence. In fact, the syntax is all wrong, and by the virtue of the syntax being wrong, it's pleading with you to put it right, to make some sense. So let's put it right. "Stay, passenger, read if thou canst, why goest by so fast?" I don't really need to talk about that. It's a very little interest, because we all know what it means. However, it's almost identical to a line from Johnson, which is another reason why we give away Johnson. "Read if thou canst, whom envious death hath placed within this monument, Shakespeare." Read if thou canst, what does that mean? It doesn't mean if you're able to read. It means figure out if you are able to. Work out if you can. Right, we're getting a smell of a riddle here. "Read if thou canst, whom envious death hath placed with space in this monument, Shakespeare." Now, I read music at university, and the music professor was a great eccentric. He said, "Don't listen to the music. Listen to the rest. Listen to the silence." I had this by my bed. I had this by my bed for 3 months, you know, and every day I looked at it for 5 minutes before I went to sleep. No, it doesn't make any sense. No, it doesn't make any sense. Then I remembered this point. Look at that gap. This is telling you something. That gap is there. We've had so many Stratfordian commentators on this thing. Oh, it's just bad carving. Doesn't know what he meant to say within. He bished it. No, let's put this in parenthesis for a second. Read if thou canst, whom envious death hath placed with Shakespeare. Ooh, we've got our riddle. Work out if you can, whom envious death has placed with Shakespeare. Ooh, he's asking us a question. Who is Shakespeare buried with? Where are we supposed to work this out? In this monument. Remember that things are carved in stone, they're carved in marble. So in this monument, work out if you can who is buried with Shakespeare. We've got a riddle. Should we see if we can find the answer? Shouldn't be very difficult. Terra, take it, right there. The earth covers. Ooh, so we've got the earth covers. We're asked who's been buried with him. The earth covers. Where's the object of the sentence? Oh, there we are. Pilium, Socratem, Maronem. These are in the accusative case. Now, just in case if some of you don't know, I'm trying to be quick, but I'm nearly there. In case some of you don't know, this is traditionally translated, these two lines, a Pilius in judgment, a Socrates in genius, a Marrow, that's to say a Virgil in art, the earth covers him, the people mourn him, and Olympus holds him. That is not the way you translate Latin. Thank you, my daughter, Mary Waugh, who's here, who told me that is absolutely out of the question wrong, because you've got that as the accusative. These are the accusatives. So the earth covers Pilius with his judgment, Socrates with his genius, and Marrow, Virgil with his art. So 400 years, Stanley Wells can't work it out. Oh, it's too difficult. It's really, really hard. What's Pilium got to do with anything? Pilius was a Greek king, never wrote anything, nothing to do with Shakespeare whatsoever. Socrates never wrote anything either. He was a philosopher, nothing to do with Shakespeare, no interest. Marrow, Virgil, Virgil, got it. Shakespeare's a poet. So we've now got a connection. However, since when was Shakespeare associated with Virgil? Never. Shakespeare, as we all know perfectly well, was our English Ovid. Shakespeare is totally and always thought of as Ovid. But we're being asked who's been buried with. None of these people, we know where they're buried. So is that the end of the problem? No, it's not. Think about this for a second. If Shakespeare wasn't in 1623 our English Ovid, who was? Right. Well, you know, this is very serious. I'm really sorry, but I'm going to run a titch bit over, but you've got to understand this, because once you get to the end of it, you'll be astonished what we've actually discovered. So, go back to 1623. Ask any semi-intelligent person, who is Arte Maronim? Who could that be an allusion to? Okay? Edmund Spenser is the answer. Edmund Spenser, the poet, extolled the Virgil himself as a god. He called him a god in the Shepherd's Calendar and Collins Clout. He was compared at length with Virgil by William Webb in the Discourse of English Poetry and by Francis Mears in Paladis Tamia. Spenser was acclaimed by Nash as the Virgil of England, and in William Covell's Polymantia, England describes Spenser as my Virgil. Charles Fitzroy, who addressed Spenser as our Marrow, compared Spenser to Virgil in three poems. Well, William Vaughan, 1598, describes Spenser. I'm sure the point is coming across. Now, when I discovered this, that Spenser was our Virgil, I rather tensely thought, is it at all possible that the next name down, Genio Socratum, because we know that Spenser is buried in Westminster Abbey. Is it possible then, because we're being asked who Shakespeare is buried, is it possible the next person on that, next person down, Genio Socratum, the genius of Socrates, might be an allusion to Geoffrey Chaucer? Seems extremely unlikely to me, but he is buried next to Spenser after all, and we seem to be answering the riddle. Woo-hoo, here we go. So I went and looked out to find out if there's anything that connects the genius of Socrates with Geoffrey Chaucer. Thomas Usk in 1387 described Chaucer as the noble philosophical poet, and William Caxton in 1484 offered a singular laud unto that noble and great philosopher, Geoffrey Chaucer. French poet Eustache Deschamps praised noble Geoffrey Chaucer as a new Socrates in 1385. O Socrate, plein de philosophie. Francis Thynne, 1544-1608, compared Chaucer's genius to the heavenly mind of prudent Socrates in his poem Upon a Picture of Chaucer. And I'll just read one more, you can see the bigger list. A Latin epitaph to Chaucer by Surigoni, recorded in the 1542 edition of his works, imbues Chaucer with the genius of Socrates. The springs of philosophy, Socrates ingenium vel fontes philosophi. Now, I will tell you very honestly, I was sweating out of the palms of my hand. There was a gush of sweat out of my fingertips, and I've just got to do this last one because you know exactly what's coming up. You're way ahead of me, but I knew that this whole theory collapses if Francis Beaumont, who's the third in that line in Westminster Abbey, cannot be connected to the first, Eudicio Pilium. And it would just be an extraordinary coincidence what I'd found, but it's over, and I wouldn't be standing before you if I couldn't do it. Now we have something, as many of you will know, called EEBO, Early English Books Online, where all the rarest books in the world are scanned and digitized, and you can word search. So I typed in, trembling, it's coming to an end, my dear fellow, trembling, the words, judicious Beaumont. What do you think I found? In Langbaine's account of the English dramatic poet, 1691, Beaumont is three times referred to as judicious Beaumont, and once as Fletcher's judicious partner, a master of good wit and better judgment. Dryden wrote Beaumont was so accurate a judge of plays that Ben Jonson, while he lived, submitted all his writings to his censure, and his thought used his judgment in correcting. In Fuller's Worthies, Beaumont is called the ballast of judgment. The same epithet is used by Beaumont in Anglorum Speculum. Beaumont was called judicious Beaumont by Aston Cocaine, who we've just talked about, in 1653. And also by Robert Anton in Philosopher's Satires in 1616, when Beaumont was actually alive. Humphrey Mozart called Beaumont the most judicious wit these later ages have. I don't need to go on. This is an extraordinary coincidence. You've been asked a riddle. Read if thou canst, work it if you can, whom envious death hath placed with Shakespeare. Work it out by reading this monument. Nobody in all the years I know up to date has connected the Latin couplet to the English that's behind it. And we seem to have an answer to our riddle, that Shakespeare is buried with Spenser, Chaucer and Beaumont in that order in Westminster Abbey, and we are being told that on the monument in Stratford-upon-Avon. Now, what's so extraordinary, and this is my last sentence, what's so extraordinary is this. You'll all know this. This is the 1743 William Kent statue sculpted by Peter Schemakers. This was added, typically, in 1972. William Shakespeare buried at Stratford-on-Avon. So we now have this extraordinary situation where we have a monument in Stratford-upon-Avon telling you to go down to London, and in London we have a monument telling you to get back up to Stratford-upon-Avon. We are being bounced around like a ping pong ball, and nobody seems to know exactly what's happening. I'll leave you with the word. I just put those about. I won't quote them. That's Shakespeare saying, "My name be buried," and all that. I'll leave you simply with the words of William Davenant, who in 1636 wrote, and why we didn't listen at the time, 1636, very long time ago, he said, "Those who go up to Stratford-upon-Avon to worship at the shrine of Shakespeare, their eyes will be mocked." Thank you.